The next item of business is a statement by Patrick Harvey on heat in buildings strategy. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Patrick Harvey, Minister, around 10 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Today we publish Scotland's Heat in Buildings Strategy, and with it we mark a significant step toward bringing to an end the contribution that heating our homes and buildings makes to climate change. The ambition set out in the strategy is significant, and rightly so, on the eve of COP26 in Glasgow. Urgent action is needed if we're to stand a chance of limiting warming to under 1.5 degrees. So the strategy presents a pathway to decarbonise our homes and non-domestic buildings in line with our statutory climate change commitments, commitments that all political parties united behind when this Parliament passed the 2019 Climate Change Act. It sets out the government's vision that by 2045, our homes and buildings will be cleaner, greener and easier to heat. This means improving standards of energy efficiency and replacing fossil fuel heating systems with zero emissions ones. It sets a clear overarching objective. By 2030, greenhouse gas emissions from homes and buildings must be 68% lower than they were in 2020. That will require over a million homes and the equivalent of 50,000 non-domestic buildings to convert to zero emissions heating in this decade. This is a huge transition affecting communities, businesses and households all across Scotland. To pave the way, it's essential that homes and buildings achieve a good standard of energy efficiency. By 2030, we want to see a large majority of homes achieving a level of energy efficiency at least equivalent to an EPC C, with all homes meeting this standard by 2033, where feasible and cost-effective. This will help to ensure energy costs in future are affordable and that we continue to remove poor energy efficiency as a driver of fuel poverty. As we address the damaging climate change impact of heating with unabated fossil fuels, we must do so in a way that supports our efforts to tackle social inequality. We must deliver a just transition. So in this strategy, we set out the guiding principles that will ensure our actions to decarbonise heat do not have a detrimental impact on the rates of fuel poverty. We recognise there are challenges. Many zero-emission heating systems are currently more costly to install and can be more expensive to run than fossil fuel alternatives. Just as we've seen with renewable electricity, however, costs are coming down rapidly and will continue to do so. But we need to work together across sectors and across jurisdictions to overcome barriers and build momentum. We'll provide support to help people switch to zero emissions heating, reducing household costs, improving homes and helping to tackle the climate emergency. This strategy that we're publishing today builds on the draft that was published in February. I was pleased to see that the draft received so many supportive responses and to see the breadth of stakeholders welcoming the scale and pace of the ambition set out. The final strategy reflects much of the insight generated through the consultation, as well as additional actions that have been agreed as part of the Scottish Government's agreement with the Scottish Green Party. We know that as we undertake the heat transition, there will be more issues to resolve, and we're committed to doing so collaboratively, drawing on the best knowledge and ideas from across society. Today's strategy sets a clear direction for the heat transition, but it acknowledges that no one at this stage has all the answers. The strategy lays a firm foundation for ongoing work, including through the refreshed energy strategy and energy just transition plan next year, and the fuel poverty strategy that will be published later this year. Presiding Officer, over this Parliament, we'll be investing at least £1.8 billion in heat and energy efficiency projects across Scotland. As well as helping to meet our targets, this will provide a much-needed stimulus to the heat and energy efficiency sector and the broader construction and home maintenance and improvements industries, contributing to a green economic recovery for Scotland. I'm pleased to announce that we are doubling the Social Housing Net Zero Heat Fund to at least £200 million. This capital funding will support decarbonisation of social housing, and it illustrates our ongoing commitment to working with the sector. We're also more than doubling the funding allocated to improving public sector buildings like schools and hospitals to at least £200 million, enabling the public sector estate to showcase zero emissions buildings. And we've committed to invest at least £400 million over this parliamentary session in large-scale heat and energy efficiency projects, including zero-carbon heat networks and large-scale heat pumps. Alongside this support, the strategy sets out further detail on how we will accelerate the transition more broadly. We estimate that the total investment required to transform our homes and buildings across the country to be in excess of £33 billion. Clearly, this cost cannot be borne by government alone. We're establishing a new Green Heat Finance Task Force to identify innovative solutions to maximise private sector investment and find new ways to help spread the upfront cost of making properties warmer, greener and more energy efficient. Investment in the heat transition will generate significant opportunities for Scotland. We estimate that 16,400 jobs will be supported across the economy in 2030 from the deployment of zero emissions heat. We'll continue to flex our delivery programmes to support local jobs and create opportunities for young people. And over the next few months, we'll co-produce with the sector a supply chain delivery plan to create new investment opportunities and support high-value local jobs. Presiding Officer, we will also bring forward a framework of regulations, setting clear standards for property owners across all tenures and building types. This framework will provide the certainty and assurance to secure investment and gives confidence to the supply chain. Our regulatory framework will build on existing standards already in place, requiring action on both energy efficiency and zero emissions heating. We'll introduce regulations in 2025 that will require all homes to reach a good level of energy efficiency, EPC C or equivalent, for example, at point of sale or change of tenancy. All homes will have to reach this standard by the backstop date of 2033, with the private rented sector having an earlier backstop of 2028. This will support our commitment to phasing out the need to install fossil fuel boilers in off-gas properties from 2025 and in on-gas areas from 2030, to the extent that devolved powers allow. Public engagement is going to be critical. While technologies such as heat pumps and heat networks have long pedigrees in other European countries, they're unfamiliar to many of us. We will increase public engagement, building on our existing advice services and taking steps to raise awareness. To support this, we'll be establishing a national public energy agency to provide leadership and harness the potential of scaled-up programmes to decarbonise heat. And we're working with local government to put in place local heat and energy efficiency strategies for decarbonising homes and buildings for all parts of Scotland. The heat transition is an unprecedented challenge that will directly touch the lives of virtually everyone in Scotland. Building owners and supply chains need to have confidence in the long-term pathway and the policies underpinning it. The scale of the challenge requires a cross-party approach. I've therefore invited party spokespeople to come together to discuss how we can work collectively to take forward our heat in buildings strategy, just as we acted collectively to set the climate change targets. This strategy sets out an ambitious package of work, maximising the Scottish Government's impact within the confines of the devolution settlement. However, we don't have all the powers necessary to deliver the transformational change required. We are therefore calling on the UK Government to take urgent action to support the just transition to decarbonise heating. The delayed UK heat and building strategy must set out how the UK Government will use its regulatory and policy levers to incentivise rapid deployment of zero emissions heat technologies. We urgently need a stronger commitment and clearer action plan from the UK Government, including reforms to energy markets and decisions about the future of the gas grid. Recent volatility in global natural gas markets further underscores the urgency of action in reserve policy areas to maintain security of energy supplies and to support vulnerable customers. Presiding Officer, this morning I had the opportunity to visit a communal air source heat pump project in Springburn in Glasgow. The project, co-funded by North Glasgow Homes, the District Heating Loan Fund and the Scottish Government's Low Carbon Infrastructure Transition Programme, delivers zero emissions heat to six high-rise social housing tower blocks. Not only will this significantly reduce emissions, it will reduce heating costs for 600 homes by up to 60%. improving tenants' well-being by making homes warmer and cheaper to heat. We need to get the transition right for every community. The heat and building strategy is the foundation for doing so, securing the emissions reduction needed from our buildings to respond to the global climate emergency, demonstrating tangible commitments to our international partners at COP26, and creating economic opportunities for Scotland and improving the buildings in which we live, work and play. And I commend Scotland's heat and building strategy to Parliament.
Thank you. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. And it would be helpful if those members who wish to ask a question were to press the request to speak button now or put R in the chat room. And I call Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement. But I'm concerned at the time it's taken to get to this point, because if the government is to meet its target set out in the statement to decarbonise 1 million homes by 2030, that means over 335 homes need to be decarbonised every single day from now until the 31st of December 2029. So this is a strategy that's heavy on what needs to happen, but light on the how. So let me try to help by asking three straight questions. Firstly, the strategy estimates that the total investment required to transform our homes and buildings is likely to be in excess of £33 billion. The Scottish Government will make available £1.8 billion. So from where or from whom does the Minister expect the other £31 billion to come? Secondly, decarbonisation requires a huge number of people to retrain or upskill in new technologies and methods. That requires people to teach them in properly funded schools, colleges and universities. Now, the strategy suggests the private sector will drive this. Yet, it also says there'll be another plan on this in summer 2022. Has the private sector confirmed they're comfortable with the cost and responsibility coming? And what is the government doing now to upskill the colleges and schools? And finally, the statement says the government wants to upgrade all homes to EPC Band C by 2033. It's reported that could cost £17,000 per household. Now, interest-free loans will be available up to £15,000, but not many households are going to have an extra £2,000 to make up the difference. So what funding will be put in place to support owners and private landlords to achieve these targets?
Minister.
Can I thank Liam Kerr for his statement, for his questions. In relation to the time that's taken, I think he knows that I and members from a number of political parties across the chamber have pushed for action on this, not just for years, but in fact for decades. I hope he's suggesting that we shouldn't have consulted on the draft strategy that was produced earlier this year. I hope he recognises the value of consultation. And I think the final version of this strategy is stronger and richer for having had the input from many, many stakeholders, much of which was very constructive. And I hope that, that he'll welcome that. The total cost of this investment between now and 2045, if that's what we want to reach by that date, is of course immense. And I made that clear in my statement. The commitment that the Scottish Government has during this parliamentary session will not be the end of the story. This is a multi-decade programme that we all need to be committed to. And yes, of course, as my statement said, it's not only going to be coming from public funding, it's going to have to come from a wide range of sources. So I hope Mr Kerr will engage constructively with our proposals for a finance task force looking at those challenges. And colleagues in other portfolios will address some of the issues in relation to schools, colleges and universities. Those are important points, and I think many of the private sector companies and contractors who already do work in installing existing conventional heating systems see big opportunities if we can give them the right support to make sure that they can get access to the work and take on more people to do this incredible programme of work to address our climate change emergency and to make sure that all communities across Scotland are able to do that affordably.
Thank you. I call Mark Griffin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Fair members, to my register of interest as the owner of a rental property in North Lanarkshire. I thank the Minister for early sight of the statement and a copy of the strategy earlier today. And in that strategy, no longer does the Minister responsible say we will transform Scotland's homes, but instead homes must be transformed. We agree that we need to decarbonise, improve the fabric of our homes and cut fuel poverty, but this strategy pushes a £33 billion bill and all the risk and disruption onto homeowners, tenants and landlords without enough funding or a partnership approach that is evident so far. That extra £200 million announced doesn't come close to reducing the burden on those least able to pay. Tony Kane of Alacho told the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee last week the government hasn't allocated enough resources and its plans put an unbearable burden on social housing tenants' rents. Low-income households have been the guinea pigs so far, subjected to useless, costly infrared heating panels in the Western Isles and being disconnected from district heating systems in Glasgow. The Glasgow City Region
Mr Griffin, could you please bring your question to the forefront? Thanks.
Certainly, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister say when householders will know what their share of that £33 billion will be, what support they will get, or if the Government just intends to regulate them into submission and debt?
Minister.
Well, I thank Mr Griffin for his question. I have to admit I was a little disappointed by the tone because, as I said, this is a challenge which is a huge challenge for all of us. It's one that requires cross-party collaboration, and I would have hoped that the Labour Party would be welcoming the idea that we're going to set out an ambitious way to achieve this agenda for all of Scotland. Can I tell every homeowner what the precise share of investment is going to be between now and 2045 for every private home? No, of course I can't do that. What we are doing is committing to ensure that we're looking at a wide range of sources for that investment. It can't all come from public funds unless, Mr Griffin, you know, even I might blanch at the idea if he comes forward with a proposal for a £33 billion tax raise so that we can fund it all from public sources. Even I might blanch at that. But look, the social housing issues that he mentions as well, I recently spoke at the Scottish Federation of Housing Associations conference about the ZEST report, Zero Emission Social Housing Task Force, and there is a real positivity and I think an appetite across the sector to work with the Scottish Government to try to rise to this challenge, because many of those social housing providers know that reducing heating costs is one of the most effective ways that they can reduce not just fuel poverty but poverty more widely, because that's a saving that doesn't get clawed back by the UK benefit system. I really hope that Labour and all other political parties will respond positively to the invitation that I've put out to sit together and talk about how we take this forward, because it is only going to work if we're willing to work together between political parties, between levels of government and across the whole of society.
Thank you, Minister. I've allowed a bit of latitude for the front bench exchanges. We have 10 backbenchers seeking to ask questions, so we need to finish by 15:25. I just put that out there. Next call, Stuart McMillan, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Brian Whittle. Mr McMillan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the statement on £1.8 billion of investment, but will the Minister provide an assurance that communities with high SIMD and growing older populations will actually be at the forefront of any rollout of this investment?
Minister.
Thank you. Thanks, Stuart McMillan, for the question. It is a very important issue. Local funding allocations for local authority-led area-based schemes do reflect need, and councils use the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation to target areas with higher numbers of fuel-poor households. And our area-based schemes, the funding enables fuel-poor households living in their own home to benefit from energy efficiency improvements. Over a third of those people are older people, and we also continue to support people converting their heating systems to zero emissions one, targeting that help again at those who are least able to pay. Our delivery schemes, which target households in fuel poverty, already take a zero emissions heat first approach. I'm conscious of time, Presiding Officer. There's a great deal more in the strategy that I think will help to answer Stuart McMillan's questions, and I'll leave it at that.
Thank you. I call Brian Whittle to be followed by Joe Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's clear that hydrogen-based boilers could play a substantial role in the replacement of natural gas boilers. While I note there's a strong emphasis on heat pumps within this document, when does the Scottish Government expect to be able to provide homeowners with greater guidance about the likely availability of mains hydrogen network within Scotland and help them to make an informed choice about the best route to take when replacing their heating?
Minister.
Thank Brian Whittle for that question. It's an excellent question. an excellent question to put to the UK government, because as he will know, it is the UK government which regulates the energy economy, including decisions on the gas network. Sorry, Mr. Whittle is shaking his head. I'm speaking about the reality. This government cannot currently control the gas network, cannot make those decisions. The UK government's heating building strategy has been delayed so long. I was really hoping they would make a big splash announcement at their party conference about how they're going to take some of these issues forward. And what did we hear? What did we hear on this agenda? They want to make it easier to arrest the people who are campaigning and protesting for insulation and for other energy efficiency measures in Scotland. That's not the response that we need, blaming the messenger. This government hears the message and is cracking on with doing the work that it can with the powers that it has.
I call Joe Fitzpatrick to be followed by Sarah Boyack.
Cultural venues such as Dundee Museum of Transport, DCA and Dundee Heritage Trust are all keen to play their part in Scotland achieving net zero. I wonder if the Minister can advise on potential support for cultural venues to undertake retrofitting.
Minister.
Absolutely, and I'm pleased that Joe Fitzpatrick sees that the cultural sector is enthusiastic, because they not only have a role in terms of their buildings directly, they can also be showcases, because many of them are publicly accessible buildings. They can help to lead that public awareness of the transformation that we need. Cultural venues will be eligible for support, but it will depend on their ownership. Public sector support schemes can help decarbonising those buildings which are in public ownership, while our SME and loan schemes can provide an offer of support to independent cultural venues. There's support also available to community organisations and national or regional non-profit organisations with charitable aims and objectives. So I would encourage all of those organisations to contact the Energy Efficient Business Support Service, Local Energy Scotland, or the Scottish Government directly to find out what may be available. And if the member has specific issues in mind in his own local area, he's very welcome to write to me on that issue as well.
I call Sarah Boyack, who is joining us remotely, to be followed by Rona Mackay. Ms Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I refer members to my register of interests? Minister, the statement didn't include reference to the opportunity to develop community and cooperatively owned heat and power networks, but in last year's Non-Domestic Rates Act, we agreed to rates relief for such low-carbon heat networks. So will the Minister agree to build on the experience of existing networks, such as the Aberdeen Heat and Power Network and the Edinburgh Solar Co-op, so we get the win-win of low-carbon networks to benefit our communities?
Minister.
I thank Sarah Boyack for that question, and I hope she knows that it's an issue that I would be very enthusiastic to work with her on. I see a really important role for the Public Energy Agency in supporting the development of skills in this area. And I know that there's been, you know, a little bit of political back and forth about whether it's an agency or whether we should crack on and create a single national energy company in the first instance. But the creation of this National Public Energy Agency will be able to do a great deal to skill up local communities, to make sure that we're sharing best practice and facilitating our ambitions for local communities taking control of this agenda. I think there's a great deal to be enthusiastic about on this agenda, and I very much hope that, again, we can work on a cross-party basis to achieve that.
I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Liam MacArthur.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. COVID-19 has put a strain on every household in Scotland, and many are no doubt wondering how we can achieve net zero while rebuilding from the hardships of the pandemic. What part does the Minister believe this strategy will play in Scotland's COVID recovery?
Minister?
Yes, as I said in the statement, we see this strategy as really critical to a green economic recovery for Scotland. We estimate an additional 16,400 jobs will be supported across the economy by 2030 as a result of the investment that's going to be deployed in zero emissions heat. In the immediate term, investing at least £1.8 billion over the course of this Parliament, as outlined in the strategy, that aims to strengthen demand and support an increase in jobs and skilled workers through investment in the supply chain. The pace of this transition is going to require a substantial growth in supply chains, particularly in the availability of skilled heating and energy efficiency installers. So we're going to be working with Scottish Renewables, to undertake a heat in buildings workforce assessment project, and later toward summer next year we'll be co-producing with industry a heat in building supply chain delivery plan. So I hope that we'll be able to maximise the opportunities that Rona Mackay clearly identifies.
And I call Liam MacArthur to be followed by Mark Ruskell.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I start by welcoming the strategy? The Minister says public engagement will be critical to strategy, but recent changes to the Warm Home Scotland scheme took place with no prior consultation, leaving some of my constituents in the dark and without new boilers they were due to receive. Will the Minister therefore commit to properly island-proofing strategy to ensure areas suffering the worst fuel poverty have their needs properly reflected, and that additional resources will be made available in recognition of the higher costs of low-emission technologies and their deployment in island and rural areas?
Minister.
Yes, absolutely. And I very much recognise the concern that Liam MacArthur has on this issue as the constituency member. He's written to me and lodged a number of questions on that, and I've made it clear in my answers, or at least I've sought to, that we do want to give the right support in the right places. We recognise the distinct challenges that remote, rural and island communities face. And we're making sure that even as we move away from fossil fuel, some of the worst and most polluting fossil fuel heating systems, we are making available the right renewable heating systems, zero carbon heating systems and energy efficiency measures in all of those communities. I'll continue to engage with Mr. MacArthur if he wants to continue to write to me, but I hope he's aware that we're making those offers available to people in his constituency and elsewhere in Scotland.
Mark Ruskell to be followed by Alistair Allen.
Thank you. Can I welcome this transformative strategy and in particular the commitment given by the Minister to work across this chamber? Hopefully that will set a better tone for the rest of this session. But can I ask him specifically about the commitment to renewed ambition for decarbonising public sector buildings? Does he recognise that within councils and some other public sector organisations, there is often a lack of capacity and skills to bring forward new projects such as heat networks, for example, or complex innovation that's going to be required to meet these targets? How does he envisage us building that capacity over time so we can really innovate and deliver?
Minister.
Absolutely. I've already set out the doubling of the funding that we're going to give to the public sector to engage in this agenda. And I would also come back to the answer that I gave earlier about the National Public Energy Agency. I think as well as supporting community organisations, it will have a critical role at building skills and capacity at local government level. I think councils across Scotland want to be part of this agenda, want to be able to show that it's something that can work for their communities. And so I would put it the call out to all members across the chamber and across political parties to work with the Scottish Government if there are opportunities in your local areas that you think we need to be aware of and work with you on and with local authorities in your constituencies and regions. We'd be very happy to hear from you.
Alistair Allen to be followed by Dean Lockhart.
I recently met with Fine Inchigall, a trusted insulation provider in my constituency. They are encountering serious difficulties because of the new UK-wide industry standards, PES 2035. Among other things, the new ventilation standards require fixed mechanical ventilation and large permanent window vents. These strict requirements in Hebridean properties result in a permanent and significant draft, made worse, I should say, by a requirement to remove the bottom 2 centimetres of every internal door, which is significantly deterring people from actually using these insulation schemes. Would the Minister be willing to meet with Tyne and Chagall and myself to discuss their concerns about this?
Minister.
Of course, I'd be very happy to have a discussion with Alistair Allen about that. I'm aware that PES 2035 introduces a new retrofit coordinator role to ensure compliance with the standards and to coordinate the work to ensure that the intended outcomes are achieved. That includes provision for improvements in indoor air quality. This is particularly true when the energy efficiency improvements are detrimental to natural air flow, in which case the coordinator may insist on additional measures to address that. However, we understand that the retrofit coordinator ultimately decides on the course of action alongside the designer. We are in continual discussions with BSI on these standards to ensure that Scottish stakeholder views are factored into the development of these standards. But as I say, I would be very happy to meet with Alistair Allen and this particular provider to look into the issues that he's highlighted.
Dean Lockhart to be followed by Mary McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Will the £1.8 billion announced in today's statement be in addition to the core budget allocated in these portfolios? In other words, is this all extra money, or is money being reallocated from other areas? And will Mr Harvey acknowledge that the massive amount of additional Scottish Government funding required in this area, and indeed required to deliver the transition to net zero, is going to effectively have to come from the Barnett formula, given that the Scottish Government is already running a fiscal deficit of £36 billion?
Minister.
Well, I mean, in relation to the first question, at least £1.8 billion is the total commitment over the course of this Parliament. I hope that's clear. As I've referenced to other members, we need to recognise that this strategy is by no means the end of the story. If we're committing to a programme of work that is as transformational as it needs to be to reach the targets that we've all voted for, it's going to have to be substantial, and it's going to have to be a multi-decade programme of work. It would be absurd for any government to stand here in 2021 and say that we know exactly what is going to happen right through to 2045. This programme for the current Parliament and this strategy lays a strong foundation for beginning that work. As for whether it will all need to come from the Barnett formula, of course not, because we'll be independent well before 2045.
Mary McNair to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister is aware of the first large-scale district heating system in Scotland was officially opened in my constituency last week. It uses water from the River Clyde to create green energy that will heat homes and buildings on the Queen's Quay site in Clyde Bank. Can the Minister outline what lessons can be learned from this pioneering system to ensure it can be rolled out across Scotland?
Minister.
Yes, absolutely. This is an example of the importance of delivery of flagship heat networks like this. This particular project is now commissioned and open, and we'll be working closely with Western Bartonshire Council to produce a lessons learned report that will be able to be shared widely to ensure that heat network projects like this can be replicated right across Scotland. The lessons from a delivery project, the delivery of a project like this, will help us also to develop a successor programme to the Low Carbon Infrastructure Transition Programme and a refocused district heating loan fund that will seek to address the barriers to the delivery of heat networks and large-scale zero-emissions heating infrastructure projects.
Thank you. And Graeme Simpson.
Many thanks, Presiding Officer. Thousands of householders are currently worried about how they'll pay for new heat and smoke alarms by next February. But the Minister says that by 2025, he'll bring in regulations which could land householders with bills of potentially tens of thousands of pounds. And he's twice failed to say how he will help people pay for that. Can he do so now?
Minister.
Thank you. I've laid out in detail how we're going to go about supporting that work to be done. And we've also, I see the scepticism in Mr. Simpson's face. I also ask him to acknowledge that there are decisions that need to be made at every level of government, including in terms of regulating the prices. This government can't do that. The UK government can and must change the pricing structure so that it is more affordable for people to operate low-carbon heating systems. But as I said to Labour colleagues earlier, if Mr Simpson wants to come forward with a £33 billion tax increase and persuade us to do that so that the public sector funds all of this work, he's very welcome to write to me about that.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes the statement on heat in building strategy. We will have a very short pause to allow any movement on front benches to change. Thank you.